Welcome to Breaking the Bank. Good morning, good afternoon, and good evening. C4ES is delighted to host this event, which will include panel discussion and ample time for Q&A. On behalf of C4ES, my name is Catherine Cartier, and I am honored to have you all here with us for this important conversation. Before we begin, please note that this session is being recorded and live streamed to our YouTube channel. C4ES is a nonprofit organization that uses publicly available information and cutting-edge emerging technologies to detect, disrupt, and dismantle transnational illicit networks. We support U.S. government, nonprofit, private sector, and media partners in defeating networks engaged in illicit activities that range from trafficking in ivory to nuclear proliferation. Today's conversation will focus on C4ADS's work to support justice and accountability in Sudan. On June 29th, 2022, we released Breaking the Bank, How Military Control of the Economy Obstructs Democracy in Sudan. Our report highlights how a repressive cartel of state-affiliated actors obstructs civilianization through its grasp over Sudan's economy. The report includes the most extensive publicly available mapping of Sudanese state-controlled enterprises to date, all of which are documented in our interactive data visualization available at sudansce.c4ads.org. In this event, we are honored to bring together experts on Sudan's democratic transition to discuss Breaking the Bank's findings. With this conversation, we hope to contextualize the impact of military control of Sudan's economy within a rapidly changing political landscape, and to identify how the international community can best support the struggle for accountability and justice in Sudan. Our discussion today will begin with remarks from four distinguished speakers: Khaled Khair, Magdi Amin, EJ Hogendorn, and Cameron Hudson. I want to thank our panelists for joining us and sharing their expertise. We are also joined by my colleagues, Zukin and Eva Khan. Isaac Zukin is the portfolio manager for Sudan projects at C4ADS, and Eva Khan is an to facilitating a meaningful conversation between panelists and participants. We invite you to share your questions with us via the Q&A function, which we will monitor throughout the panel. Please use the Q&A function instead of the chat. Without further ado, I will hand it over to Eva to introduce our first speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. And noting the comment on an audio cutoff, I'm Eva Khan, an analyst here at C4ADS on the Sudan portfolio. I'm honored to introduce our first speaker for today's discussion, Khaled Khair. Khaled is the founding director at Confluence Advisory, a think and do tank based in Khartoum. She is also a contributor at the Tahrir Institute for Middle East Policy, and her analysis has appeared in Al Jazeera, Foreign Policy, and on NPR, among other notable publications. Khaled, over to you to start us off.
Thank you, Eva. Good morning, good afternoon, everyone. I'll briefly discuss some of the political implications of this work and of the findings of this report, which is the first to outline such a large number of enterprises that have connections to the deep state, and for that reason could provide a much needed evidence base for judging how the deep state operates. Having this body of findings also helps to situate recent and emerging developments in Sudan, as well as historical ones. The timing of the release of this report was particularly opportune, I think, ahead of the statement by General Burhan, in which he states that he intends for the military and security constellation to leave the tripartite mechanism talks, and particularly that he intends to hand power over to civilians. Understanding how the deep state uses such political moments and denouncements to regroup and to preserve its finances and interests is critical to evaluating the authenticity of Burhan's statement. In reality, such a decision made unilaterally and without discussing financial accountability, nor indeed transitional justice and security sector reform, the three issues that we know undergird the regime's clinging to power, makes this move appear much more as part of a consolidation than a concession, capture rather than compromise. Indeed, Burhan's statement, the subsequent removal of civilians from the Sovereign Council, and the barely legal intended setup of a Security and Defense Council, or Higher Council for the Armed Forces, that retains control over the central bank, foreign policy, and undefined sovereignty issues, appears to constitute a second, more calculated, evolved phase of the October coup, concentrating the military's power rather than diluting it. In the interest of time, I'd also like to briefly point out three things. Firstly, that historically, Sudan's security apparatus has used coups as a way to build the state. Secondly, that the reconfiguration of the deep state with every phase of this coup has implications for aid flows, particularly direct aid flows to government. And thirdly, that the insights to how state-controlled enterprises are embedded in the regime and its state can support a more robust sanctions roadmap. So this idea of coups as state building, the political theorist Charles Tilly posits that war makes a state and the state makes war. In Sudan, a state that was created largely through colonial enterprise, the oldest and most well-maintained institution, the armed forces, has since independence seemingly used coups as a means to make and remake the state and align and redefine the cleavages within Sudan, as well as the structures that govern how resources are redistributed and distributed. Breaking the Bank outlines how the armed forces, through the Special Fund for the Social Security of the Armed Forces, used the coup in 2019 to redistribute shares, increase control over state-controlled enterprises, and set up new alliances with the fall of Bashir. Further, the Transitional Period's Dismantling Committee, while beleaguered, managed to target some of Bashir's asset-rich faithful and pool their finances. This was tolerated to some extent by the military, as long as it didn't touch the deep state's assets, and in hindsight, also probably because it made capture of some of these funds easier for the coup regime. While some of the personal funds were given back post-coup, as the report shows, 2 years earlier with the fall of Bashir, many assets were redistributed to build new alliances ahead of the October coup. Therefore, to borrow from Tilly, coups make the state, and the state or the military makes coups. One interesting thing to note is that because the Bashir regime set out in earnest to capture the economy, unlike, say, Aboud, and to some extent Nimeiri before him, the deep state in Sudan was able to engineer a coup post-revolution much quicker than in transitions in the 1960s and the 1980s. This means that today, to bring about lasting democratic change, the dismantling of the economic control of the military should be considered a priority and not an afterthought. Dismantling these financial networks identified in the report is a sine qua non of the democratic change in Sudan. So what does this mean for funding coming from outside of the state, such as foreign direct investment and aid? The obvious takeaway is that any funding coming in, while this coup or some variation of it is ongoing, will immediately be absorbed into the state and used to maintain the deep state. Both foreign direct investment and aid can come with conditions, but no number of conditions can counter the deeply entrenched mechanics of the deep state as outlined in the report. Shortly after the coup, we saw the Ministry of Finance issue a letter to open bank accounts for several of the armed movements that have signed the Juba peace agreement, but have yet to disarm and are suspected of rearming and recruiting. This is just one example. Obviously, this will have grave consequences on active and emerging conflicts and has already had implications for the conflict dynamics across particularly Darfur, but increasingly also South Kordofan. A recent ACLED report showed that Sudan averaged more than 14 political violence events per week over the past month, which is up from the same period last year before the coup. There have already been pressures for donors to restart funding, both budgetary support and to return funding from that was promised during the transitional period and has since been paused. But the findings of this report show, situated in political and economic development since October, is that the regime, struggling to survive without liquidity, is investing whatever financing it can get to stay afloat and maintain the new patronage system, not identical, but similar enough to Bashir's. Prioritizing its own survival means even less attention and funding is provided for services and salvaging the economy or preparedness for crises on the near horizon, such as famine. What the 2019 experience and the fall of Bashir illustrate is that the economic collapse and inability to provide for citizens is not necessarily the death knell for an Islamo-military regime, merely an opportunity to politically and economically restructure. It follows then that some serious intervention is needed in order to counter the longevity and evolution of the military and the deep state behind it. Many calls for sanctions have been made by both Sudanese and non-Sudanese, and this makes sense in the face of such unjust practices by the regime. Sanctions offer a satisfying censure. That said, sanctions absent a strategy for Sudan make little sense and may do more harm than good, or at the very least be ineffective. And aside from a strategy, the appropriate conditions will also need to be in place to ensure that any sanctions are meaningful and targeted in a way that dismantles the regime's hold on the economy, including political conditions outside of Sudan. And unsatisfyingly, some measures may not need to be punitive, but regulatory. For example, the instituting of antitrust laws, fair taxation, and competitive tendering processes. Instituting such measures will require much greater knowledge on how decisions around ownership of state-owned enterprises, both formal and informal, function than countries with the ability to sanction currently possess. But this report can offer a strong foundation to support a more robust sanctions roadmap, as well as other alternatives. Thank you.
Thank you, Khaloud. Next, I'm honored to introduce Megdi Amin. Megdi Amin is the former senior advisor for the Sudanese Ministry of Finance. He is also the founder and managing partner of African Renaissance Partners. Prior to his service in the civilian-led transitional government, Amin was the managing director of Omidyar Network, ON, focusing on global strategy, early stage investment in beneficial technology, and ON's digital identity program in Africa. Megdi, the floor is yours.
Thank you. Just make sure audio is working. Good. Okay, thank you so much for this report and the opportunity to provide some comments. Thank you, Khaloud, and thank you everyone who's joined, other panelists as well as the guests. I'd like to build on a few points that Khaloud made, but also speak to some of the findings of the report, and then talk a little bit about the way forward, some of the work that we were doing that may need to be built on and continued. First of all, I think we all understand that Sudan requires a military that's accountable to the people. It's no bigger job in Sudan, given its history, given the neighborhood, given the state of development, that security is a huge agenda, and it requires focus. Fundamentally, I think, as Khaloud was saying, the question is whether the military will serve as a core pillar of an independent, peaceful, and secure Sudan, or does it serve its own interests? And the distortions we see today are really 60 years in the making. The army at independence was meritocracy, was multi-ethnic, and had committed to staying out of politics. That changed with Aboud being, in fact, invited because of various failures in the initial stages, but then going well beyond the initial request to provide some stability while some solutions were being found to really stay until he himself was overthrown. But it was really Numeri, particularly after the 1971 coup led by army officers, that then shifted the doctrine to really supporting the regime as opposed to its traditional role in support of the state. And then under al-Bashir, it's really complete distortion, including creation of alternative entities, NIS and RSF, along with the oil wealth and some of the foreign partnerships, all of which played a role in creating an entirely different setup. And the enterprises play a key role in that setup. So, you know, ultimately engagement in politics and business is a distraction from the core mandate, a very important mandate. And I would also say that the sort of top-down structure that a military needs in order to maintain doctrine, and certainly you need one military, not six or seven, is not really well-suited to the issues that Sudan faces And I would argue, actually, the much more decentralized structure that the resistance committees use, although it is difficult for decision making, actually is relevant. It is much more top, much more bottom up, much more community led and anchored. The report, I thought, was made a very strong contribution. There's both a strength and a weakness in how it brings together enterprises that are directly owned by the state, indirectly owned by the state. And I would say it doesn't really differentiate very well between SOEs that are a result of a fairly badly performing state-oriented economic model versus those that are the result of the distortions that Khalud discussed and mentioned in terms of over time how the military came to find itself needing to own a lot of enterprises. This is also a strength because it captures the entirety of the dilemma, which is not new, which is new. We had not seen published in one place all of these things, and certainly the way that it's presented is a great strength. But all of these types of enterprises actually require different solutions. So let me make a few comments on what I would consider some of the possible ways forward. And the underlying premise is, again, the economic viability of the Sudanese state, either the national treasury ultimately under the auspices of the parliament and working on behalf of the citizens, the economic viability of that state is in the military's interest. The government must be fiscally viable. There needs to be a substantial, given the security issues, a transparent and substantial budget for security and for the military, but it needs to be transparent. And the economic structure should focus really on building the private sector, building jobs, extending services to people. And we really can't have, we need to have that as a core focus, as a principle as to how we think about the enterprise sector as well. Of course, tax revenues, and again, the core issue of transparency. Another key issue beyond just getting the budget going and dealing with the enterprises, I'll speak a little bit more about that, is the financial sector. To actually build the economy, you can't have a financial sector as small and as marginalized as it is in Sudan. And in order to do that, we need a different governance arrangement. And to regain correspondent banking relationships, you need much higher standards as far as anti-money laundering and countering the financing of terrorism. Those standards include the fact that you need to flag who's making the transactions according to the risk of the customer. And so you can't really have a financial sector in which politically exposed people, which is an element of risk, are owners or directors of financial institutions. So that needs to be reformed and needs to be implemented. Fit and proper tests to be conducted on major shareholders of banks and of all key institutions in the financial sector. So it's a non-starter also, among the proposals that we recently saw, that the Central Bank of Sudan would report to the Security Council as an aside. So what to do about these enterprises? So we were working on it. This really started with the first minister in the transition, Dr. Badawi. He was focused on getting transparency and effective management of SOEs. We had discussed that actually, when you think about what to deal with SOEs, you really need to figure out what do you want to do in the sector. So starting with a sector strategy and then think about, is there a role for any state enterprises, and then what should it be? In many cases, the decision would be ultimately to divest. But I think there will be state enterprises for a while, and I think there would need to be a holding company for state enterprises, similar to the Singapore, Malaysia model, clear commercial and policy objectives with transparent metrics. Management of SOEs need to be performance-based, not patronage-based. I think once the structure is set up under the Ministry of Finance in a legitimate government, there can be, for example, floating of a portion of such a holding company to the public, and importantly, the appointment of independent directors that could speak to what is the national interest in making sure that these enterprises are competitive, but also not distorting competition against the private sector. So again, going back to the core principle of creating jobs and building the state, really any competition against the private sector needs to be very much limited. And finally, I do think once there is stability in a recognized government, there should be a process of divesting those enterprises that do not play a role in a clearly defined development strategy. I hope that's useful, and I look forward to having further discussions with you after the panelists.
Thank you, Magdi. I'm delighted to introduce our next speaker, Cameron Hudson. Cameron is a senior associate at the Center for Strategic and International Studies. He was previously a senior fellow at the Atlantic Council's Africa Center and the executive director of the U.S. Holocaust Memorial Museum's Center for the Prevention of Genocide. Cameron served as the chief of staff to presidential special envoys for Sudan during South Sudan's separation from Sudan and the Darfur genocide. His analysis has been featured by the BBC, Al Jazeera, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, Foreign Policy, Voice of America, and NPR, among others. Cameron, thank you for joining us. And briefly, before Cameron starts, I'd like to note we've seen some hands up in the participants channel. We won't be calling on people throughout this webinar, but you can put any questions you have into the Q&A box, and we'll do our best to answer them during the discussion portion. Cameron, over to you.
Great. Thank you, Ava. And thanks to everyone joining today. I see a lot of friendly names, at least, in the participant list. And congratulations to C4ADS on this really useful and substantial report. I'm honored to be here on this panel, speaking alongside friends and colleagues. I wanted to make just a few observations about the report itself. And underline a few points that have already been made by my colleagues, and then offer some thoughts on where we might go from here. I think that first and foremost, what this report does is it reminds us that Sudan and the Sudanese economy is upside down. This is a military state with a civilian component, not just now, but for the past 3+ decades. And as the report accurately assesses, despite the political advances of the transition, I'm quoting here, the economic structures built by the SAF and the RSF were only minimally affected by the transition. Secondly, I think there's a notion out there that we arrived at this state essentially through organic growth over time, that the military and security forces during their uninterrupted period of authoritarian rule slowly extended their reach into different parts of the economy. And while some of that organic growth may be true, I think that what this report helps to illustrate is the intentionality of these deep state forces to develop, grow, and most importantly, obscure their control over critical nodes of this economy, right? This was not accidental. The state that we find ourselves in, the state of this economy, is by design. Thirdly, I think there is again a kind of popular conception that while the military controls some number of military-oriented companies like the Jihad Network that's noted in the report, much of their revenue comes from the manipulation of state finances. And this report, while it doesn't address acts of corruption or patronage, of which it's fair to say the entire Sudanese regime is built upon, it does underscore, I think, a far more insidious aspect of the military's involvement, and that is their control of legitimate businesses in sectors as wide-ranging as shipping and trucking, livestock, agriculture, infrastructure, all sorts of industries that have nothing to do, frankly, with national security interests or military interests. And while those are not necessarily quantified here in the report, it is breathtaking the amount of crowding out of legitimate ownership, legitimate job and wealth creation that the deep state has deprived the Sudanese people of. And I think that's sort of in between the lines of this report. Fourth, I think the report reveals just how difficult these forces have made it to effectively rid them of their economic stakes, while at the same time not triggering a collapse of the entire Sudanese economy. As we see in this report, if 86.9% of Omdurman National Bank is owned by military-affiliated companies or entities, then one might see it as a real prime target for Western sanctions. Similarly, Al-Khalij Bank, the RSF-controlled financial institution noted in the report. But what share of these accounts at these banks are legitimate business and private citizen accounts? People simply attempting to run their businesses, run their personal finances. These forces have so deeply ingrained themselves into the fabric of economic life of the country that unmaking this is going to be a Herculean task in need of outside technical support. And if we hope to not further undercut any economy and population already on life support. And then I think my last takeaway from reading the report is just being reminded of how important the work of the Regime Dismantlement Committee was and is, and just what a blow it is to see that work undone. The seizing of 126 state-owned companies, and now their return to who knows which entities of the deep state. One thing is for certain, however, and that is deep state forces are once again hard at work right now as we speak, trying to obscure their stakes and the revenue flows from these 406 companies listed in this report, which in my mind means that the information contained in this report is highly perishable, and that every day, week, and month that the U.S. and other governments do not use this report to take action against these forces, to stop and block their continued profiting and obscuring of these assets, the less valuable this work becomes and the harder the task will be of ever dislodging the deep state from its position of economic dominance. So I think that leads into just a couple of recommendations that I might make going forward now. First, I think it's critical that we start planning for the day when civilian leaders once again have access to the economic levers of the country, and that we have a plan in place for working with a future regime dismantlement committee. We did not clearly support that regime enough when it was in place, and we have hopefully an opportunity once again in the future to underline that support, God willing, right? Inshallah. You know, Western support must flood into Sudan when that opportunity arises to make this work less reversible than we saw it already was. That means being on the phone now with KPMG and Deloitte and other accounting firms and having personnel identified now who can assist with the work of tracking and seizing these assets before they are dissipated into the kind of the ether of new ownership structures. Second, I think we need to be thinking about ways to avoid what the military could well be planning, which is further privatization of these companies to allies inside and outside the country. We're already seeing Gulf and other well-funded neighbors bargain shopping for Sudanese assets right now. We need a diplomatic strategy to prevent this from happening any further that holds Sudanese assets in Sudan for the ultimate benefit of Sudanese people and its economy, and take lessons from the many similar efforts that have taken place across Africa and Europe, where oligarchic classes have been created through these fire sale efforts. Third, I think this report should be referenced in a reissuance of the U.S. government's Sudan business advisory. The fact that this report points out that reputable U.S. firms like Valmont Industries are still entering into substantial new business relationships with military-owned enterprises, is a huge problem. And then lastly, I think this report is a gift to the Treasury Department and to its Office of Foreign Assets Control. With this information, there's nothing standing in the way of directly targeting not just entities, but individuals in Sudan. And I think, to be clear, we need to be messaging that these sanctions should not be viewed as punitive per se, but as a means of freezing aspects of the Sudanese economy, making it more difficult for them to sell off, break off and alter their ownership structure. So I'll end there and look forward to the conversation.
Thank you, Cameron. Lastly, I'm honored to introduce EJ Hogendorn. EJ is a senior advisor in the Department of State Africa Bureau on Sudan and South Sudan. EJ was previously the International Crisis Group's Africa Deputy Program Director and an arms expert with the United Nations panels of experts on Somalia and Sudan. Prior to that, EJ worked as a researcher for the Human Rights Watch Arms Division and with Amnesty International. I'll note before EJ speaks that after EJ is done speaking, we'll start in on the Q&A. So if you have questions that the speakers have inspired over the last half hour, please put them into the Q&A box, not the chat. We'll be monitoring the Q&A box more closely. Thank you, EJ, and go right ahead. EJ, I can't hear you. I just want to check that other folks can. Okay.
I know EJ is still, I can't, he's not audible.
Confirming that EJ is muted, I'm going to give him a moment to reassemble that. EJ, if you want to leave the call and join again, feel free, since I know we could hear you in the green room. And I'm happy to take a brief pause to give you a moment to get back in. While we're doing this, I'm going to take a moment for some free advertising. I noted that there have been some questions both in the chat and in the Q&A. about the data involved in our report and how you can access it. So let me tell you, you can access all the data involved in our report pretty easily online. I'll be dropping these links in the chat both now and at the end of the event, but you can view the entire report in English or in Arabic on the report launch page, which is c4ads.org/breakingthebank. You can also view all of the data in the report and lots of data that didn't make the final cut of the report in our data visualization explorer, which is at sudansce.c4ads.org. EJ, I saw that you rejoined. Do you want to try talking and see if we can hear you now?
Yes, let's see if it works now.
Awesome, you're back on. Go right ahead.
Okay, apologies to the audience. Do not know what problems there are, but obviously I think most people are now quite comfortable or are aware of these technical glitches that happen all the time. Thank you for your patience. And because, and to some degree, because I've already taken up some of your time we do wanna allow a lot of time for discussion and Q&A, I'll try to keep my comments relatively brief. I just wanted to note that, you know, it's been many decades that the United States has sought to help the Sudanese people and their democratic aspirations. And this, of course, includes efforts to promote good governance and accountability. The U.S. engagement in Sudan increased dramatically since the beginning of the popular protest in December 2018. I'd also like to note, and the reason I'm here is I wanted to emphasize that the United States State Department fully supports the intent of C4ADS's Breaking the Bank report and agrees with its assertion that the surreptitious control of banks, import-export companies, and processing plants have and continue to allow security officials and former regime officials to create these vertically integrated monopolies that have undercut the domestic civilian enterprises and hobbled Sudan's economy. It is our findings that this uneven playing field is deterring many companies from doing business with and investing in Sudan. The United States also believes that this can only be changed by greater transparency and accountability. And this is one of the reasons that the the United States Congress passed the Sudan Democracy Transition Accountability and Fiscal Transparency Act of 2020. That act laid out the U.S. policy to, one, support a civilian-led political transition in Sudan that results in a democratic government which is accountable to its people, respects and promotes human rights, is at peace internally and with its people, and can partner with the region for stability. It also instructs the State Department and others to pursue a strategy of calibrated engagement with Sudan that includes, among others, facilitating an environment for free, fair, and credible democratic elections, supporting reforms that improve transparency and accountability, strengthening civilian institutions, judicial independence, and the rule of law, promoting the role of women in government, the economy, and society, promoting economic reform, private sector engagement, and inclusive economic development while combating corruption and illicit economic activities, including that which involves the Sudanese security and intelligence services. And last but not least, supporting improved development outcomes, domestic resource mobilization, and catalyzing market-based solutions to improve access to health, education, water, and sanitation, and livelihoods. In that effort, the United States and other donors pledged billions of dollars in economic support, including to this family support program and debt relief. However, as a condition for debt relief and as a part of its effort to advance a democratic transition, the transitional government committed to a raft of economic reforms. While the government did initiate some fiscal reforms, it failed to significantly improve Sudan's legal and commercial framework, which continues to favor state-owned enterprises. The military takeover in October of last year forced the US and other donors to pause most of their assistance. In addition, because the military takeover continued and because of the lack of economic reform, the United States government also issued on 23 November of this year an advisory on risks and considerations for US businesses operating in Sudan. It highlighted the growing risk to American businesses and individuals associated with conducting businesses with Sudanese state-owned enterprises, which includes all companies under military control. That advisory determined, and I quote, "Sudan's military has long controlled a network of entities, and following its seizure of power on October 25, 2021, it is in effective control of all state-owned enterprises. Further, Sudan's military is increasing its direct control of Sudan's many state-owned enterprises, and plans for civilian control over state-owned enterprises have been abandoned." So much like is described in the C4 ADS report, we assess state-owned enterprises and other military-controlled companies now play an unusually large role in the Sudanese economy and are involved in a range of non-military commercial activities, including fuel storage, natural gas projects, solar panel manufacturing, infrastructure, the railroad sector, cotton and textiles, and the food industries, including flour milling, bread production, and animal husbandry. While the exact number of state-owned enterprises are unknown, we assess there are at least 650 companies that are state-owned enterprises, and at least 200 of them are directly owned by the military. We should add that these state-owned enterprises have a history of sinecure and self-dealing that have sapped Sudan's fiscal and economic resources. State-owned enterprises benefit from preferential treatment from government and lacks transparency and oversight compared to private companies who are held to a much higher standard by the government, which has allowed state-owned enterprises to also dominate the Sudanese economy. Furthermore, we wanted to stress again that Sudan still ranks as one of the most corrupt countries in the world, according to Transparency International. And added to that, Sudan is Africa's third largest gold producer, and state-owned enterprises and military-controlled companies control much of that trade in the country and its export abroad. This trade is poorly regulated in Sudan and is also linked to child labor and the use of mercury for refinement, amongst other concerns. Gold smuggling costs the Sudanese state large amounts of money in lost revenue. And I should add that it's not just the United States that's concerned about these issues. The IMF also advised the state about its concerns about state-owned enterprises and pushed for broad-based economic reforms to state-owned enterprises and their gradual transfer to the control of the Ministry of Finance. As I mentioned before, all those efforts have been paused as of now. Now, in conclusion, I wanted to make several points. The United States and its partners paused assistance to the current government and will not resume our assistance until a civilian government is restored. The U.S., however, will continue to support the Sudanese people and it's increasing its humanitarian assistance in face of growing insecurity. The United States also took note of General Burhan's address and his stated commitment to dissolving the Sovereign Council once a civilian government has been formed, pending an agreement by civilian partners. We thus encourage all stakeholders to continue negotiations in effort to get back to a civilian government. Last but not least, once there is a return to a civilian-led transitional government, the U.S. is prepared to resume phased assistance linked to the new government instituting reforms that we have discussed, including to state-owned enterprises. In conclusion, we urge C4ADS and others to continue their work to promote transparency and reform and hope that this will continue to help support the Sudanese people's efforts to promote democracy and good governance. Thank you.
Thank you, EJ. Now that we've had a chance both as an audience and also on the speaker panel to hear from each one of the speakers, I am going to open up the table for a more comprehensive conversation. However, before I start out with a set of moderator-led and audience-derived questions, I wanted to ask if any of our panelists have direct responses to one another's comments that they'd like to sort of kick us off with. All right, hearing a little bit of silence, I'm going to take the moderator's prerogative and ask a question to the panel generally. Anyone who's interested can pick this one up. I think Cameron made a very interesting point that the US should start planning now for the next transition, that inshallah, if we're in a world where we are able to support a new transitional government, that there are some new and different steps that the US government might take. Given that we've just heard an excellent sort of layout of the US government position, I was wondering if any of our panelists have priorities that they'd like to put on that list in order to think about how a new handling of a Sudanese transition might go forward.
Happy to get us started on that. Broadly speaking, the question of U.S. assistance post resumption of a civilian economic, a civilian transition to democracy. So first of all, I think security sector reform is really central to the prospects of for democracy. And what to deal with, how to deal with the enterprises, how to move to a structure where there is transparent and sufficient funding of a single unified military so that there isn't this need for, first of all, competing entities that are creating enterprises for off-budget financing. That's so U.S. engagement in security sector or international engagement in security sector reform, I think would be quite helpful. There used to be very strong relationships and partnerships between the Sudanese military and the U.S. A lot of, in previous generations, pre-Bashir generals and senior staff were U.S. trained. And I think that's important not only to help bring around security sector reform, but also to counter some of the other countries that seem to be coming in, including entry points through enterprises that are not very helpful either to Sudan or to the international community. So I think there is an important engagement for the US. Obviously, I think the other point he was making that we do need to focus now on getting a transparent process for fiscal reform, getting all of these issues really prevented the consolidation of the budget, and therefore drove all of the macro problems that we were having during the transition. So that kind of help would be needed. And if we were to resume the dismantling committee, and if we are going to focus on the rule of law, that dismantling committee is needed, but it also needs to have due process. So there would need to be some oversight and appeals and those sort of structures that were on paper, but not fully implemented, do need to be implemented. So I think there are lots of engagements and entry points, institution building and transparency and good governance in how Sudan operates its budget, but also how the military operates, I think are key areas for US support.
Thank you, Megdi. Cameron, I saw you unmuted. Go ahead if you'd like to also answer that question.
I was gonna leave Khalud the chance to weigh in because I sort of waited on this, but I'll just make maybe a slightly different point, which is that related to what Magdi just said, I think the sequencing, I think that we can't overcomplicate an already extremely complicated and complex situation in Sudan. And so I do fear that we can sometimes be kind of too smart by half by thinking that there is some sequencing that's going to work here. I hate using the analogy of, we're going to build the plane as we fly it, but I think that we need to be thinking about doing all of these things sort of simultaneously. We can't wait for a civilian government to be in place and sufficiently empowered to then begin to undertake security sector reform. These are mutually reinforcing processes. And so I think that we have to be pushing on all of these fronts, whether it's financial transparency, whether it's security sector reform, whether it is empowering, a new government. Again, this is all predicated on the idea that we're going to get back to a transition and get back to a state where we have interlocutors on the Sudanese side who we can work with. And I think from what Khalud said at her opening, I think that's in question right now. But let's assume that we can envision those moments in the future. I think that we need to be not overly concerned about what is the exact sequencing of all of this, because it all needs to happen. And I think that if we try to extend this out in a kind of linear fashion, we've tried that before, and that tends not to work because the military is really adept at creating new roadblocks along the way. And so the only way to, I think, really tackle this problem is by trying to do all of these things at once and pushing on them at once. And I think, the underlying current, and I've said this, probably too many times before, I sound like a broken record on this, but there has been too little effort to rebalance the fundamental balance of power in the country in favor of civilians, and to try to disempower the military and the kind of the broader kind of NCP Islamist elements of this country. And unless and until we do that, and I think sanctions is one way and an important way of trying to do that, I think the fight is never going to be fair going forward. And so that needs to be, in my mind, if we're talking about sequencing something, the very first thing that we need to begin to do to rebalance this playing field. And even then, it's not going to be totally in balance, but it's a start.
I'll briefly comment just to say that, if the US is serious about engaging on Sudan, then it has to ask itself, has anything it's been doing so far since October been successful? And I mean, the short answer to me is no. So this requires a radical rethink of the US's approach to Sudan. And when you say the US's approach to Sudan, who do you mean? Do you mean Congress? Do you mean the State Department? Do you mean the White House? They all seem to have very different ways of, sort of conceiving about how to engage with Sudan. So I think the US does need to get its house in order and very quickly, and come up with a Sudan strategy that actually makes sense and that has all branches of government actually singing from the same hymn sheet. Because, I mean, we hear ad nauseum that, you know, the civilians in Sudan are too divided and they can't, you know, get their act together. And I would say that's a problem probably across the board, including in the international community. That massively undermines anything that the international community does. We're only just starting to see some of the envoys, you know, sort of work together and try and leverage their combined political, you know, clout. But we haven't really seen that come across very cohesively or very much in the strategy. And again, it's very disparate actions. And of course, this works absolutely in favor of the military, who, as Cameron said, have become very good at changing the rules of the game. And in such a fragmented international space, they're basically having the time of their lives right now.
Thank you, Khalud. And thank you everyone for your thoughtful remarks on that question. I'm going to turn to two of the audience questions that came up and resonated, I think, with each other. There's a question from Gillian Lusk as to why the deep state is not being addressed as an Islamist entity. And there's another question from Abdul Moiz Labib about how to address the role of the rapid support forces, or the RSF, within the deep state. So thinking about these sort of in conversation, I wanted to ask our panelists, and I know Magdi, you actually brought this up as something you see as both a strength and a weakness in our report, how we can disambiguate between different parts of the deep state, both in analyzing sort of its role in controlling the economy and also in crafting a more comprehensive, coherent international strategy. So I'll turn that over maybe to Magdi first to think about this role of disambiguation, then open it up to the rest of the panel.
I'm not sure I fully got the question, but just to take a little bit of a shot at it. So, you know, in order to move forward, there needs to be sort of carrots and sticks and reward those actions that are moving us toward a transition to democracy that's fully civilian, and that includes a reform of the security sector and this enterprise question related to it. If we're talking about RSF, you know, sort of my understanding is that they've been quite resistant to integration into one security sector, at least publicly, and I think there are some, you know, some cares being taken in terms of how it's handled. But I think the longer that that institution or that network of institutions operates with impunity and develops and strengthens itself and its ability to sort of buy off other actors and loyalties, it really prevents the transition. So I think if I was to think about where do sanctions need to go first, you know, we're in a key moment, and I think that we do know, make a point on the Burhan initiative, but I think that the sanctions on RSF were quite important to make this transition happen, simply because of the obstacle that they're playing and the fact that, as the Cameron's point on the level playing field, there cannot be a level playing field if one actor is gaining resources and all of the other actors or most of the other actors are not. I actually think the Burhan initiative should be taken quite seriously. I think that the combination of those protests, the street, the economic conditions, and others has really forced a rethink, and that whether or not this is, you know, serious or not, or there's a bluff or anything like that, the action among the civilians is to go forward with a proposal for the institutions that need to be built to govern properly, including the economy, and I think that that would need to happen in any case. The continued pressure will eventually bring that a possibility into existence. So we need to prepare now. The civilians need to prepare now to take power with the right institutions. All politics is messy around the world. Democracy is messy. There's no really no waiting for perfection and entire unity among all civilian actors. It is really time to take that and just put forward and move forward with the transition.
Thank you. Thank you, Magdi. Is there anyone else on the panel who'd like to jump in on that? Cameron, I see you're unmuted.
Well, I would just say, I mean, I had a similar kind of response when I read the report initially, right, which is the deep state is a kind of catch-all phrase that captures a lot of the kind of political actors in Sudan. And obviously, we need to be nuanced in how we think about, you know, the SAF from the RSF, from Islamist forces to, you know, former NCP, to the sort of the civilian politicians who are, you know, more associated or in line with the coup. I mean, all of these different actors have a role to play. They have influence, they have leverage, and to some extent they need to be managed in different and nuanced ways. Again, though, you know, I hear a lot from international diplomats about how complicated the situation in Sudan is, and so I'm cautious about advocating a kind of an overly nuanced approach, because I do feel like the international community has been in the cul-de-sac of nuance around this for, you know, certainly since the coup. And I think that is in part of the problem that we face. And Khalud referenced something that I had told her earlier, right? Which is, you know, it's the military that keeps taking these actions and resetting the rules of the game. And every, you know, every few months, they take some aggressive new action that forces the international community to kind of rethink its approach. And that's a very, you know, smart tactical move. And they've been doing it, frankly, ever since I've been involved in trying to negotiate with the Sudanese, going back to the CPA, right? They certainly did this to the Darfuris back in the day. They did this to the South Sudanese back in the day, which is to constantly kind of play a new card in this game that resets the entire rules of the game. And so we're still playing the last set of rules when they've changed the rules on us. And I think that that's why I'm sort of advocating for, you know, a kind of a flooding of the zone. I mean, obviously it has to be backed up by what Khalud said, which is, you know, a real understanding of the strategic approach, what we want to achieve, how we intend to achieve it, what resources we're willing to put at this. That conversation, I don't believe, has happened in any kind of serious way. But we cannot allow ourselves, I think, to be caught up in the nuance of some of these actors, when I think we need to be moving much more aggressively. Because again, I think the timing, the time is of the essence here. You know, especially with the report, as I said, I think it is perishable. And I think that these actors are doing what they can right now to further consolidate their control, to further consolidate their ownership over these institutions and entities. And the longer we wait to take any kind of action, I think the more opportunity they have to make it difficult for us to undo what's already been done.
I want to jump on that last point, because there was a similar question in the Q&A. Khalifala Bushada asked, why do you think sanctions have not been levied so far, and what is the administration waiting for? I saw that Magdi marked that he would like to answer this. So Magdi, go ahead. And then afterwards, I'd love to hear from EJ.
I think I might have started that answer already, but basically, I think the U.S. Is very invested in a diplomatic solution. There are lots of sensitivities in terms of maintaining the quality of that dialogue, but also concerns about the risks, for example, of conflict arising between several of the entities that have been discussed as potential sanctions. So I think out of an abundance of caution and not making things worse than they are, but also trying to have some hope for moving forward with a negotiated outcome, I think that there has been those delays. But I think the point that we were making is that not acting is also consequential. If one particular entity is gaining resources at the expense of the other, you are changing the situation on the ground that's in a way of quite unfavorable toward a successful transition. So not acting is a strategy. Let me just leave it at that. But I just to add a couple of points on the previous questions as well. I do think there are different types of enterprises discussed in this report, and some of them need different treatment. Some of them are not, they're not really about sanctions. Some of them really should be part of a transparent management under the state. And until time, there's enough stability where one can talk about divesting. Divesting now under these circumstances would be a huge loss to the Sudanese people. But in the future, some of them can be divested. Right now, it's not, you can't treat sort of Khalij Bank the same way you would treat, you know, some directly, you know, RSF-owned enterprise, for example.
Thank you, Magdi. I turn it over to EJ if he has a response on that as well.
Yeah, I figured I'd have to respond. I mean, just to state the obvious, but sanctions have unintended consequences. And so we want to be quite careful about when we take any kinds of actions. And as someone who was deeply involved in the rescission of the state-sponsored of terrorism designation that took the United States a long, long time to unroll, I just want to note that it can be very difficult to kind of unroll the impact of sanctions. I continue to have to tell my interlocutors that there are no U.S. sanctions on Sudan, even though they continue to tell me that there are. We continue to struggle, even during the Hamdok government, to encourage U.S. banks and other entities to do business with Sudan because they were what in the terminology is called over-complying with past sanctions regimes. So I just want to note that these are difficult issues. That said, we have imposed sanctions. We've imposed sanctions on the Central Reserve Police for the actions that they took against protesters and the atrocities they committed. We have also made it abundantly clear that all options are on the table, and we will apply those when we think they are appropriate. We have determined through an interagency process that at this point in time, we don't think those are appropriate. But we have also made it very clear to us what our goals are. In the meantime, we have put a lot of pressure on the military authorities. I've already mentioned it in my presentation, but we have paused billions and billions of dollars in support that was going to
I just lost EJ's audio. I want to confirm that that happened for other folks. All right, EJ, if you can hear us, we cannot hear you. I'm going to ask you to probably either mute and unmute or exit and rejoin. All right, I'm going to give EJ a moment to jump back in. While I do, does anyone else on the panel want to remark on that question on sanctions timing?
I can be a bit provocative. I mean, as I said, sanctions need a strategy and the US doesn't have one. So I think the trepidation that Majdi spoke about, the inaction so that they don't get it wrong, is partly a function of the US's own lack of strategy. Cameron was right that, you know, sometimes you don't need to sequence everything, but some things absolutely need to be sequenced in that you do need to have a sense of what's going on before you can just, you know, have a ham-fisted approach towards something that you hope will work out and may not. But I don't think that that should discount sanctions as an option. I think, in fact, what it behooves the US to do is investigate how and under which conditions sanctions should be levied, not to decide whether to enact them or not. That kind of binary is not exactly useful. And if the conditions aren't there, then how could those conditions be brought about? That's the kind of useful undertaking that would be good in a moment like this. And EJ's back.
Welcome back, EJ, just in time to hear some provocative remarks if you'd like to respond to them. And then I'm gonna ask our panelists, I have one question that I'd like to close with the last 10 minutes. So EJ, go right ahead.
Well, apologies again about the audio problems. I don't know what the issues were, and I'm not sure I caught all of what Khalud was saying. But you know, rest assured, we are looking at all of our options. You know, we are looking at all the available information that is being provided to us through our own means, and also through reports like C4ADS is putting out there. You know, these are active discussions. As I mentioned before, these tools remain available to us, and when we believe it is appropriate, we may put them in place.
Thank you. I want to turn to a couple of the questions in the chat that have addressed the role of civil society in countering state-controlled enterprises and military control of the Sudanese economy. We had a couple of different folks ask what the role of civil society organizations is, particularly civil society in the diaspora, and what kind of advocacy or research could help sort of accelerate this effort to end military control of the economy in Sudan. I would love to start this off with Khalud, if she's interested in answering, and then open it up to the rest of our panelists.
Sure, thanks. There's also a sort of linked question to that, which is about civic processes and how they could sort of streamline some of these questions that we're having. I think the thing to note is that I personally don't find that the Sudanese economy has ever been that fair. So this idea of returning to some golden era in the 50s or 60s when everything was just right and the military wasn't involved in the economy is, I think, not where we want to be. At the time, there was very heavy monopoly by certain aspects of what I guess we could term the middle class, which has, of course, vastly changed since then. And bringing about those kinds of monopolies, you know, there's a reason we can all list about five families that have control over some sort of aspect of the Sudanese economy. Maybe in the 70s and the 50s, it was 10 families, but regardless, it's a very small number of people compared to even the size of the Sudanese economy, which I grant you is not that large. So I think these things we need, when we think about reform and when we think about instituting sort of fair practices, we need to think beyond the military, we need to think beyond some of these informal networks. We need to think about the way the Sudanese economy is run, even in the formal sense, and even with the sort of the older, you know, classes, if you will, that we had. We had oligarchies before we had military oligarchies. You know, there's a reason that Osama Dawood is now, you know, swanning around the Middle East and particularly the UAE, getting $6 billion deals at a time like this. You know, the deep state is not just the military. The deep state is not just the Islamists. It is people who are looking to make a quick buck and a very big buck out of the instability and the chaos that reigns. So when we think about how we streamline some of these things and how we work with certain actors, we do need to be prioritizing those who don't have a stake in the economy being the way it is, i.e. very easy to pillage. We need to think about some of the civic processes and some of the civic entities that do have an interest in a more broad access to the economy. And so, you know, Mehdi mentioned earlier, the resistance committee's obvious example, because they have, they stretch far and wide across the country, and they actually are an entity that evolves with the political moment. They are not stuck in a political imaginary of the 1960s and 1980s. Their political plan is not to go back to the good old days when education was free, but everything else was terrible for a lot of people. Those are the kinds of the imaginaries we need to invest in. Rethinking what it means to have a functioning economy for all, job creation, et cetera, that's outside of the sort of usual class-based rubrics that we've seen before.
Thank you, Khalud. I'll take a moment to see if anyone else on the panel would like to remark on that. If not, I have a couple other closing questions.
I mean, I'll just say briefly, I mean, I think we have to be careful when speaking from Washington about our ability to kind of turn the screwdriver here and have it have an impact 5,000 miles away. You know, and I think that when we talk about having an influence in, you know, we've talked a lot about sort of sanctions and sort of direct U.S. action, but I think, you know, in the long run, part of this mythic strategy that we're all hoping materializes at some point from our government and other governments is about empowering groups of people that are going to make these changes. We're going to have, we, the US government, I'm speaking now of, and other governments have to work through through allies and partners on the ground. And I think we haven't spoken enough in this setting about, frankly, the lack of faith and the lack of trust that so many of those partners who should be natural partners of, you know, of pro-democracy Western alliances have in us at this point, given our own conduct in the country over the course of the last, whatever it is, 9 or 10 months since the coup. And so I think when we talk about empowering those groups, I think first and foremost, we have to talk about regaining the trust of those groups. And then being in a position to empower them through support, technical assistance, financial assistance, and the like. And I know that there are efforts underway to do that, but sustaining that, augmenting that over time to build and empower allies who are the ones who are ultimately going to be doing the work on the ground. We have to be, I think, humble and cautious about what it is we hope we can achieve from, you know, from London or Washington or Brussels or wherever it is. And I don't think we've spent enough time really talking about how to empower those groups who are going to be the change makers on the ground.
Cameron, that's an excellent point and queued me up perfectly for so the last question. I wanted to turn to the panel. There were a few questions in the chat about the potential impact of sanctions that we're discussing right now on civilians, particularly employees of these companies, but also people who engage with them every day and generally the Sudanese economy, which is, as many of our panelists have noticed, sort of on a precipice. I'd like to see if any of our panelists want to take 30 seconds to address how this impact on civilians can be mitigated if such a sanctions policy is to be implemented.
Let me just kind of connect this and the previous question. I think what we're trying to say is that we need economic entities and institutions, particularly those that are linked to the state, to be working for the good of the state, in other words, the good of the people. Not their own interests, but the good of the people. It means, going back to the question of sort of oligarchies, that in order to do business in Sudan, you don't necessarily need to be part of the state because your interests, again, doing business in Sudan is about managing risk. And if you can only manage risk by being closely associated with the state, then we're never going to get a broad-based economy. It'll always be an economy for the few. We need to the Sudan needs to change that. The resistance committees, through their level of awareness, if you read the Khartoum state charter, is very clear in their level of awareness about the need to change fundamentally the nature of the state to be much more bottom-up and decentralized. And, you know, decentralized meaning livestock, meaning agriculture, meaning many other industries that are dominated by entities right now that are very close to the regime and cannot be if we're going to get that broad-based growth. So they play a key role just through their awareness, and the report is helpful. I think further reports that differentiate the different kinds of enterprises and solutions for those different types of enterprises would be helpful. Again, thank you for all your questions and comments.
Thank you so much, Meg D. I do regret to inform you all that it is 12:15 and we are reaching the end of our panel. I will allow any of the speakers, if they would like a last 30 seconds to respond or make closing remarks, to do so now. But I'm going to give you all 30 seconds and then I'm going to close. Pending any further remarks, I'll start closing right now. Thank you all for joining us, both to the speakers and to everyone in the audience. Although we're out of time for today's conversation, we would love to keep engaging with you all on this material and everything else that we do here at C4ADS. I'd like to note that there were a bunch of excellent questions in the Q&A and in the chat that we did not have time to answer. If you are particularly interested in an answer to them, feel free to follow up with C4ADS via any of our multiple communications platforms. platforms. If you haven't done so already, we recommend you check out our report at c4ads.org/breakingthebank and explore our interactive data visualization at sudansce.c4ads.org. In addition, if you know of any state-controlled enterprises that we haven't accounted for in our visualization or our report, and you'd like us to account for them, we encourage you to drop us a line at tips@c4ads.org. I'll put that in the chat as well. And if you want to keep up with C4ADS, feel free to sign up for any of our myriad communication platforms, email lists, follow us on Twitter, follow us on LinkedIn, follow us on Facebook. Thank you all so much for taking the time for this conversation today. A huge thank you to our panelists, and have a lovely morning, afternoon, or evening, wherever you are.
Thank you, Eva, and thank you, panelists. Thank you.